Okay, so this is Neuronymous here with a quick episode with a buddy of mine, Michael Murphy. He and I met at my work, our job, which we never ever mention on this show. He and I we just kind of jam about movies and talk about movies and stuff, and we're just kind of doing a little impromptu conversation. One thing I've made it pretty clear about my hatred about MoviePass. Not hatred. Hatred is such a terrible word to use, but my disappointment with it, because I was seeing movies constantly, and now I never get to see movies anymore, because they're too fucking expensive, to be honest. Mike here is basically gonna we're gonna talk about movies that I haven't seen before, but we're gonna ha but we're gonna but I want to hear about him, and he's gonna kind of review some movies that I have yet to see. So, like I said, this is gonna be a short one, but I think it's gonna be a lot of fun. He's got a lot of cool things to say, and I will bring him on here shortly. All right, so Mike, how's it going?
Good. How you doing, man?
I'm doing all right. I'm doing all right. I lost my uncle yesterday.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I lost. Yeah, I know. Really heavy shit. Bringing right into it. Yeah, I lost my uncle yesterday, so I've kind of a little bit in a funk, but I talked about that ad nauseum in another episode that's gonna be coming out here in a little while. I've managed to wrangle the beast, Jasper here. He's sniffing the floor. I don't know what the hell he's doing, but anyway. So I haven't seen a lot of movies lately. I've seen Mandy, and I saw a really cool movie from a couple years ago that somebody was really nice enough to send me called The Way Way Back. Have you heard of that one?
No.
You know who Sam Rockwell is?
Yeah,
He's
definitely.
in it, and Tony Collette is in it, and Steve Carell's in it. Basically, Steve Carell plays this overbearing, like, soon-to-be stepfather, and there's this awkward kid, and his mom, and Steve Carell, like I said, plays the overbearing soon-to-be stepfather, and they go on to this summer home, this summer home, and this kid gets involved with all these people at this water park, and Sam Rockwell becomes sort of like his like kind of like a father figure to him, but Sam Rockwell is his usual Sam Rockwell-iness, very fast talking, kind of funny, like just irreverent. But no, it was really good. But yeah, those are really the only movies. I'm going to be seeing apparently The Meg tomorrow, and you mentioned that you've seen The Meg, right?
I did. I saw the Meg.
How was it?
It is sort of what I expected.
I love me some Jason Statham, so.
And since they spent like $100 million on it, it certainly hit on all the right notes of what you'd expect. You've got the very impressive, enormous shark, and I don't know. I actually enjoyed it enough to where I picked up the Meg on Audible, and I listened to the novel
Did
too.
you?
Over
Oh,
the,
was it good?
yeah, I'm the novel's good too. It's read by sort of someone I wouldn't expect to be reading it. It's a sort of nebbish sounding guy, but you
I had
know,
nothing to do with
yeah, fair
it.
enough. But it's definitely not. Somebody who sounds like Jason Statham,
Yeah.
growling and sort of threatening.
Yeah.
He sounds like, and he doesn't sound like the author's description of the main character either, which is sort of weird. And I don't know. I don't know if you listen to a lot of audiobooks.
I don't. I just
I listen to a ton of audiobooks, and sometimes the reader can really make or break it. I enjoyed the narrative either way, and I think Steve Alton's a good writer, but I think this guy's a weird choice of of readers.
They made the wrong call on this one. Huh?
I don't know. You know, so, like, I'm a big fan of Lawrence Block, who's one of the best mystery writers ever. I mean, he's
Matt Scudder's series.
Exactly, Matt Scudder and the Bernie Rodenbaugh series. And for any of your listeners who missed it, he writes a series of short stories about an attorney named Martin Ehrengreff.
Oh, really?
Which is some of the bleakest and most devious fiction that's ever been written. I mean, it is incredible. And we all have these preconceived notions about attorneys and defense attorneys in particular.
Yeah.
But Martin Ehrengreff, I would hate to spoil the surprise, but Martin Ehrengreff goes well beyond any kind of deviousness that that your average attorney would go to. So really one of the guilty pleasures of fiction. But yeah. I obviously digress. I remember, though, I've listened to a lot of his audiobooks and, you know, the Matt Scudder series. And I think even the Bernie Rodenbaugh series, I think Richard Ferrone maybe, or somebody with a kind of a tough guy voice.
Yeah.
Read a lot of them, and then there was one where the author read it, and I was sort of excited because that's kind of cool, you know. Yeah, sometimes
I would never want to hear Stephen King read a book.
Yeah, probably.
Like,
I don't know, but when you look at Lawrence Block's photograph on the book jacket,
right,
he looks like he's most of the time, you know, more recent anyway. He's got a kind of a tough brush mustache and shaved head, and he looks sort of like not exactly a tough guy, but he's very clever looking, and he doesn't look like you could push him around, you know.
Robert B. Parker had that same look too.
Sure.
Yeah, like he looked like he could be Spencer, like,
but know. when he reads the book, he sounds like a sort of nebbish academic New Yorker, where he's sort of like he would definitely know where the best bagels are in his neighborhood, you know. And very nasal too. I was just sort of surprised. And
you sure wasn't like Jerry Seinfeld or something like that?
It was very very Seinfeldish, and it's the same thing with the Meg. So
yeah, that's really weird. I mean, like I said, I don't really do the whole Audible books because I've got a really short attention span. I can barely listen to, like, my own podcast. Like, for, actually, that's not true. I listen to my podcast ad nauseum to the point where, like,
really?
It's gotten to the point where my wife is like, "Are you listening to yourself again?" And I'm like,
that would make me crazy. I can't stand the sound of my own voice.
You know what? Here's the deal, though. I actually don't mind the sound of my voice, and then I hear my laugh. I've got this really high laugh, and like everything is golden. I mean, I'm not saying like that, and I'll be all a podcast because obviously, you know, I've only got 25 followers, of course. But
and that's, you're basically homeless.
I'm basically homeless, yes. And but like, you know, I sound pretty good, and then I'm like, I'm like, oh God, just stop. Just make it stop.
Well, all you have to do is never laugh ever.
Right. Great. See, I can't.
See what you did?
See what I did there, yeah. You know, so I think, like, I might have to pull, like, with, I haven't seen A Star Is Born, but I really want to see it because I love the soundtrack. But apparently, you know, have you seen it? A Star Is Born with Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga?
No.
Okay, well, here's the deal. Bradley Cooper had a look, like, completely learned how to lower his voice a whole register.
Wow.
And his voice, singing voice, is amazing. So I'm wondering if maybe I might have to, like, learn how to lower my voice a whole register so my voice will be like, you know? Yeah, I know. This is a weird podcast, dude. You just gonna have to learn to go with it. Because you just, I see your one eyebrow raise, and you're just like, I don't know what this fucking thing is doing. Anyway. But no, I don't get out.
I mean, I think I remember in the 80s, everybody wanted to talk like Jack Nicholson.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So, here's the deal, Sparky.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, I mean, Christian Slater, I mean, like, he was, people thought he was going to be the next Jack Nicholson. And,
he probably would have been without the savage, you know, habit. I mean, he had everything going for him.
Yeah.
I went and saw Cuffs in the theater.
Oh, right? My God, I wanted to see Cuffs in the theater. My parents wouldn't let me. Was that, I think, that, I feel like. The,
sterling that, piece of film, let me tell you.
Yeah, oh, is. God, I've seen Cuffs in my 37 years, I have seen Cuffs.
Pretty juvenile.
Yeah, it's not good. But I do love him in the movie True Romance.
Milla Jovovich at her Milla Jovovich-est.
Yes.
So, I mean, stunning.
Oh, yeah, she was in that, wasn't she? Yeah. Oh, I love me. I'm trying to
remember where that falls, before or after the...
Fifth Element?
No. It was definitely before Dazed the Fifth Element. Dazed and Confused.
Yeah, it was before Dazed and Confused, breakout. For sure, yeah.
And I don't know how much influence she wielded on the set there, because she performs, she's like playing one of her songs.
Yeah, she's a brilliant singer-songwriter.
She's very talented.
Yeah, and you know she's a good actress too. She has a lot.
I met her.
You
at
what?
A bar in Houston.
You
yeah,
met her?
I met Milla Jovovich, and it was one of and the oddest. I'll try and keep this story short. And
no,
I know this
absolutely.
Is all about
I
want stories. To
hear the whole fucking thing, dude.
So, you know, I was living in Houston and taking some classes there. I was like barely old enough to drink. And in fact, I think I recall being 21 because Milla Jovovich, I think she and I are about the same age. And
you are ancient.
Yeah, I'm pretty old. she was touring with her band.
Right.
She had an album. The Divine Comedy.
Yep.
Check
yep.
it out.
I've seen it. I've listened to that.
So she had sort of collected this assortment of street musicians that she just sort of accumulated in Europe, according to her story. I had the biggest crush on this girl named Karina when
That's
I lived
cool
in Houston, name. And she was just super cute, and she had this friend named Aaron who was sort of an odd duck, and Aaron was like just part of the scene with our buddies that were in school together taking classes in Houston, and so he would like he was always sort of around, and he always had a car, so you know and he was just sort of a nice guy. I take it they had all kind of gone to high school together, and I was I had just semi-recently moved to Houston, so I didn't know a ton of people.
Right.
And so Aaron was like, well, hey, dude, we should go see Mila play. And I was like, right. I don't want to go see a model try to be a musician. That's
right.
Probably going to be terrible.
Yeah.
Like, nobody had seen and you know, heard any of her songs yet. And he was like, oh, she's so hot. You know, I was like, I don't care.
Well,
like, how's that going to...
He's not wrong.
Yeah, agreed. And he was like, well, I think Karina's going to be there. And I was like, oh, well, yeah, let's go.
You're there.
No problem.
I had to see about a girl.
So so we go to this place. I'm trying to think of the name of the... It had some odd name, like Club Sum or something like that. And it looked like it was a dump. It was just some homemade club. In some shithouse neighborhood in Houston. And
are there shithouse neighbors in Houston?
Tons of,
really?
You know, closer you get to downtown.
I just hear Houston's like,
there's sections
place.
Of Houston that are literally fenced off from downtown.
Really?
Where it's sort of like there'll be the Galleria and then a few blocks away an industrial complex.
Really?
And on the
weird.
Other side of that, it's just demilitarized.
All I've ever heard of Houston is like that the streets are like paved with gold. That's all
if
I've ever heard.
There's a neighborhood that has the word ward after it, like third ward or fifth ward. You don't go there
unless you're
strictly trying to procure like crack or heroin.
I may have been there then.
And I have other stories about that, but
okay, all right.
not about purchasing heroin, but about ending up in the wrong neighborhood by accident. But,
yeah. That's a different story.
So we drove to this club, and the whole time we're there, Aaron, who is this sort of like would-be Lothario, he's very, very romantic minded in sort of a tragic fashion. And he's like really heavily anticipating, and I'm trying to ignore him and enjoy myself, right? So
sort of like this right now.
We're all standing around, and I'm like, okay, dude, just relax. And he's like, dude, she's like super hot, right? And I'm like, all right, dude, that's fine. And the music starts, and she plays extremely well. Her musicians are all really good. And actually kind of different from the album, which is sort of heavily studio produced and much more synthetic. The set was much more organic, as I recall. But the thing is, Aaron's next to me the whole time, and he's just like, oh, man. You know what sucks is that, like, chicks like that would never go for a guy like me. And I'm like, yeah, that's kind of how it goes, you know. I wasn't on right. the cover of Vogue last month
right,
either,
yeah, no.
You know. And Aaron is sort of this little bit egg-shaped dude.
Egg-shaped, huh?
Yeah, I mean, he's not. He had kind of a squint to him a little bit, and he was just not. I mean, you know, he was a cool guy. He wasn't like, you know, leading man material or anything, and he was just like, well,
he's like Jack Black
maybe. Well, you know what, well, yeah, I mean,
he's
maybe,
like a character actor, he wasn't a leading man.
Yeah, we'll say that. I'm not trying to bag on him. He was a cool guy and all, but he was sort of like, well, you know, do you think a girl like that could ever go for a guy like me?
And
I'm like,
he asked you this.
Yeah, he asked me this during this show, and I'm like, no. Yeah. And he's like, why? I'm like, because why would she? She has her pick of Hollywood and musicians, and I mean, she's married, what, like three different movie directors or producers now?
Luc Besson, and then
Besson?
Paul W.S. Anderson,
right?
Who directed all the shitty...
That will probably... Yeah. And I'm like... And somebody else before that, too, I thought, but I could be wrong.
She's like the Elizabeth Taylor, like, really crappy directors. Except Luc Besson has directed a few pretty good movies.
Sure.
Not Valerian, though. I'm sorry.
Valerian is not.
I bought that movie.
It's very hectic.
It's one of those movies where, like, it's really pretty to look at, but there's literally nothing... There's no substance to it whatsoever.
It's rough. I think that people are very nostalgic about Valerian.
Yeah.
Because apparently it was a huge phenomenon, not just in France, but in a lot of places. Yeah. But Luke thought, you know, huge nostalgia for these people that I think are out there, plus ridiculous gobs of money spent on visual effects.
Right. Right.
Gold.
Yep.
Right?
Yep. There you go.
And it didn't quite get there, and I don't know if it's the edit or if... frankly, the actors are... I don't know if that guy can cut it, but the girl was... Just her performance was wooden and dispassionate, and, I think she'd be in line to play the next Terminator or something. I don't know what the deal was.
Yeah.
Maybe they didn't give her anything to work with.
And he's a pretty... I've seen him in other things. The lead, the Valerian. Sure. He's a pretty decent actor. But he's not... I don't think he's leading man material.
I don't know.
I feel like we just completely digressed from your middle of it.
Yeah, so Aaron goes from... it's too bad that a girl like that could never go for me to, do you think a girl like that could ever go for me to, now he's angry about it. It's not fair that a girl like that could never go for me.
He's getting resentful.
I don't know what the five stages are, but at some point he gets to, well, if she got to know the real me, we're only like three songs in, so I'm like, Jesus Christ, this has got to stop. So, and this is the kind of thing that made Aaron difficult to cope with sometimes. And yeah. I was probably not a great friend to him, but I don't think I was his worst friend either. We hung out a bunch of times. I liked the dude, and you know, eventually I didn't live in Houston anymore, so we lost touch. Yeah, but
right.
But so he grabs like the local rag. You know, every town has a rag. Like in Mankato, it's like the Riverside Times, or in I'm sure the Omaha, Twin Cities have a,
yeah, there's the Reader.
You know, something that tells you what bands are playing where.
Yep,
and you can pick it up free in you know, any wherever. They have it by the door, and he picks up one of these. He's got a black magic marker for some reason, and he starts writing bad, like, juvenile poetry. You know, the kind of stuff where you use the word azure because it sounds poetic. He starts writing this shit just right over the print in magic marker. And he's just going to pour out his soul. And then he's going to show this to supermodel actress Milla Jovovich. And they're going to walk off into the sunset, right?
Wow.
Because, I don't know, because...
That is chutzpah, as
we,
as we
were not high or even drinking, as I recall. Like, I barely had $5 to my name at that time. So, so the show's over. He's, like, spiraling out into his, I don't know, bizarre fantasy world.
The ether.
I'm ready to get going. We're all just kind of hanging out, and the band has scurried off to this like back hallway / green room, and
yeah.
Because this place is, I really don't know what it used to be, like a youth center or something that got turned into this just homemade nightclub.
Right.
But I see one of the band members, like the guy who played the teeny tiny mellophone or whatever you call those teeny tiny keyboards, right?
Sure.
But Mellotron or something, sort of peek his head out the door and then scurry back in there, and some dude from Belgium with a crazy goatee, you know, and I'm like, so if you want her to read your poetry, you gotta show it to her first. And he's like, oh, no, dude, I couldn't do that. And I'm like, yeah, just do it. What's the worst thing that can happen? And he's like...
Oh, that's never a good thing to ask.
So I take it from him because I'm like, Aaron, I believe in your dream.
Oh, God.
And I shove it under the door. And,
What?
And, like a couple minutes later, this Mellotron player sticks his head out the door and goes, is this yours? And I go, oh, hell no. It's his. He goes, you guys should come hang out.
Oh, my God. No, are you you're shitting me?
So we need to go back there and hang out. And
so his poetry worked.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Aaron, your poetry is better than I think it is. Let me tell you. So
Aaron,
if you're out there.
You did okay.
If you're still alive in Houston or anywhere. So yeah, we actually, and I, you know, I thought it was cool. You know, we got to meet the band and they told us about, you know, where they were from. And, you know, obviously this is 20 years ago and I have very little recollection of it. But, you know, I was trying to ask her a lot of questions about like, wow, where'd you find these guys? And, you know, tell me about Europe, you know, tell me about your travels. And it was actually really cool. They were passing around the biggest joint I'd ever seen to that point.
Did you smoke?
I don't smoke. You know, I'm very sort of straight arrow,
you
straight edge Boy
straight
Scout.
Arrow,
and people don't believe me when I say this, but she offered it from her lips to mine, and I said, no thanks, I'm trying to cut down. And that was my meeting with Milla Jovovich. I had a really cool time.
I'm
she didn't pressure me,
down.
You know.
It's not like cheesecake.
She was on the cover of High Times, you know. So she is very pro marijuana, obviously. But and I, you know, that's
for
fine.
About
I
my
got,
whole 20s,
I've got no
so
beef
was I,
with
was, yeah.
with marijuana. I just don't happen to partake. And and I thought that was very cool. You know, we chit chatted and. You know, after maybe 20 minutes of us kind of hanging out, they started letting other people filter back in there and hang out, and we eventually filtered out, and Aaron was on cloud 9 He couldn't believe that. I mean, indirectly, this touched her lips and then his lips. So,
so just for the record, Michael.
Yeah.
Had this been, had I been in your shoes, if she offered me that, and said, put it in rectally, I would have done it.
Yeah. Well, yeah. She swings.
But you turned it down. Kudos, man.
I'm a man of strong convictions.
That would have gone straight up the asshole if she had asked me to do it.
And she was cool about it. You know, wasn't a thing.
Yeah.
And I really enjoyed hearing her stories about traveling in Europe. And I know at least one of those guys was literally a street musician that she picked up and was like, you're in my band now. You know?
I can just see this episode. It's going to be like, Michael Murphy. I'm interviewing him, and his new claim to fame is he turned down a joint for Milla Jovovich.
Yeah.
But Milla Jovovich is pretty.
And once you turn down a supermodel, you can pretty much turn down anybody. Absolutely. Peer pressure is not really a thing after that.
You have nothing to lose. Which is pretty much the way, really the best way to be. Yeah.
Look at him. So we thoroughly wrung this topic out.
We really did.
We were going to talk about movies. Yeah, we were.
You know, but this is all gold, man. And just for the record, I really don't cut out a lot of stuff. So all of it is going to go in there.
So, conclusion, Milla Jovovich, super hot then, probably pretty damn hot still now. Cool chick.
Absolutely.
Very talented, multi-talented.
Yeah.
Right.
Event Horizon. What movies? What's the
her big franchise? Yeah, is Resident Evil.
Yeah, Resident Evil. I can't want to say Event Horizon.
Which
Resident Evil? I have not seen one film of those.
Resident Evil is.
I don't play video games.
That's a tough one for me because, first off, I have fond memories of the game, right? Yeah. Resident Evil 2 was the first one I played, and I went back and played Resident Evil 1 after that. And everybody remembers the scare when the dogs, the zombie dogs jump through the window, breaking glass, and it's very startling. And especially, you know, you play it in the dark, right? You do everything the whole nine, and they were cool games at the time. Very pixelated now, although they've literally remastered all those games. You can play it now in high definition.
That's pretty cool.
And I'm sure the controls are better and stuff like that. But
Everything's better now. I don't play video games, but I'm sure it's better than. I still have my 1988 Nintendo. That's the only video game I've never upgraded. Right. I still have the little pistol for Duck Hunt.
Well, and so the games make you feel a certain way. So you know that gives the movie some cachet.
Yeah.
And then you kind of hit all the right notes. Like zombies are awesome. Mm-hmm. Milla Jovovich, you know, stunning, right?
Yeah, right.
Action.
Yeah.
But I'll go ahead and say, I mean, in today's cinema world where everything, you know, verisimilitude has never been higher in cinema. I mean, we have, you know, if you watch Jason Bourne, you're watching somebody who is executing like real life high speed, fight moves that work.
Right.
Not stuff that looks badass on
Chuck Norris.
Yeah. Van Damme doing splits and just trading kicks until the bad guy falls down, but stuff that's meant to just put somebody on the deck in the shortest amount of time possible. I mean that
Steven Seagal kind of came close to that.
Yeah. Well, and I think that was very good for that.
Do you ever watch Steven Seagal run?
Not anymore. He doesn't do it anymore.
He looks like Jim Belushi now. I mean,
he's had a tough time.
Yeah.
And I mean, a lot of the things.
I think
people's objections to Steven Seagal are sort of like
he's very mysterious.
Well, and I think he's sort of So, for example, my parents, my mom's Japanese, my father's American, and my father was, his objection to Steven Seagal was like, okay, this guy goes to Japan.
Right.
He marries the daughter of the preeminent Aikido sensei in Japan. And if you watch, there's plenty of footage of him doing Aikido in Japan.
Oh, yeah.
And nobody could just, not just anybody, could become a teacher of Aikido in Japan. Like,
right.
And then he came back to America and started teaching, and then he got involved in movies. But
married Kelly LeBrock.
Yeah, and he ditched his Japanese wife and married Kelly LeBrock. Jeez. So my parents were like, wow, what a dick, right? Kelly LeBrock is probably a whole nother podcast, right? But happened there?
Yeah, like Botox or Botox City.
Oh, I can't. I don't even want to think about it.
Hello,
remember Weird Science? She was such a crazy chick. She had that cool accent.
What would you like to do now, my maniacs?
Yeah, that's
like
great.
That. Yeah, she...
nerd bait.
Kelly LeBrock.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah. When you watch an action movie, it's supposed to, and Resident Evil's never quite done that. You know what I mean? It's the action is clearly Hollywood, and the weapons handling and all that stuff. It's a lot more John Woo than it is,
right?
You know, realistic.
That's why I liked that movie Brawl in Cell Block 99, that with Vince Vaughn. You know what I mean? Like, you
that movie's grim.
That is a grim movie, but it's
bleak.
It was probably one of the best movies of last year, I thought. In fact, I think it was number two on my list, because it was one of those movies where you just never know where it's going, what direction it's going.
Well, and the thing about that
Vince
is...
Vince Vaughn was just...
Vincent Vaughn he used to be in great movies.
Yeah, you Swingers.
Know? Swingers is great,
yeah.
And Swingers is the one that everybody knows, but... And I tried to steer you towards these.
Return to Paradise, too.
Return to Paradise is great.
He's fantastic.
And I mean, such a terrific performance, such great material... You know, great people he's working with. Joaquin Phoenix and Hayes delivers. And
yep.
I mean, I don't know. He was like, agent, remember all that good shit I used to do? That bitchin' indie stuff?
Yeah.
Fuck that for a while. I'm going to make that dollar, and I'm just going to trudge through. Like, he just was phoning in everything. I mean...
Yeah.
Whatever movie he did opposite Jennifer Aniston, and then
the one he did
with Owen Wilson,
yeah,
where he was
wedding,
sort of
Wedding
Google.
Crashers, yeah.
Wedding Crashers he was at least awake for.
Yeah,
I enjoyed Wedding Crashers.
That's a good movie.
By the time you get to, and what was the one with Jennifer Aniston?
The Breakup.
By the time you get to The Breakup.
Really not a comedy at all. It's really depressing.
He looks hungover the whole movie.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he might say to us, well, that was what my character was. He was sick of it all. Well, okay, dude, but we would like to see you look like a mammal and not not like a walrus, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I mean,
he's
just sort of like...
He seems like he's kind of packed on the pounds, and he's just kind of like... Meh.
Yeah, I don't know.
They might as well just cast Patton Oswalt instead.
If Patton Oswalt was 6'7", done. You know what I mean? And Patton would, I'm sure, put his all into it.
You know who I really miss? And he's been in a few movies, and he's directed a really good couple movies. And this is going to be very controversial, but I still love Mel Gibson. Like... Talk about a troubled guy, you know, and this is coming from a recovering alcoholic and addict, you know, like, I mean, his movies, like, are just gold. I mean, I haven't seen Get the Gringo, but I learned that, I mean, I was actually lit on Facebook, wrote a review for Hacksaw Ridge. I don't know if you saw that.
I did.
Yeah. I thought it was a great movie, but so he made Hacksaw Ridge, and I gave it a really glowing review because I loved it, and I got called a bad Jew. Like, somebody on Facebook, a friend, no longer a friend, called me, "You're a bad Jew," and I'm like, what?
Well, that's what you get for being a bad Jew.
Yeah, I know. I guess that's what happens. Yeah, I know. I do eat pork, so sorry, Rabbi Allen. Here's the thing, like,
politics right now are so
it's very
over the top that if free men can't discourse about their opinions and their I do think that people are obviously spoon-fed a lot of stuff by the media,
right?
And most of the people that I try to talk about, like, I don't want to talk about politics.
No, neither do I.
But I do want to be able to talk to people about, you know, what is your basis for this belief? Like, how did you arrive at this?
Sure.
And almost nobody can have that conversation anymore. I mean, right. It's a real failing of our education system, I guess. I was going to say, I watched Bloodfather, which came out in 2016.
It was great.
And I thought it was terrific, and he was probably his actual comeback vehicle, where
I would have, I watched,
because he did. He was like, it's too hot. I'm hiding behind the camera.
Yeah.
You see my name on it, but I'm going to print it real small. We're just gonna
Bloodfather was fantastic.
Keep it on the low low. Yeah.
It was almost, I mean, it was, not only was it a good action movie, but like, there are scenes that actually made me kind of get teary-eyed when he was telling, tells his daughter, like, how sorry.
Most definitely.
I mean, here's the thing. The man completely spiraled, but his talent didn't go away. Yeah. You know what I mean? And the thing is, like,
they're not going to let him make Lethal Weapon 5 after all that brouhaha. No, but they're not going to let him be in the next.
No, but what's really funny,
Mad Max movie
that we brought up, Vince Vaughn, is they are starring in a new movie together from the guy who did Bone Tomahawk and Braun Cell Block 99, and it's called Dragged Across Concrete, which is probably that's a very telling title for a movie with those two. But
I'll have to look for that.
Yeah, no, it hasn't.
I still haven't watched Bone Tomahawk, and I've got it at home, actually.
Really? Oh, it's such a good movie. It has one of the most gruesome scenes I've ever seen. Yeah, and I've seen a lot.
That's the thing.
I've seen a lot of gruesome things, but even I was just like, okay. Okay, that's fucked up.
The gruesome stuff, but I definitely either have to be in the mood for it, mm-hmm. or, more importantly, my wife has to be on board now.
Yeah.
So now that we're joined at the hip,
surgically attached.
Some of that stuff is curtailed, and I do have some time when I'm at home, she's at work, and I can do my own thing. But for a long time now, that's some of that stuff's been out of the rotation. Like, I really like to watch Hong Kong action films and Korean action films and stuff, and I haven't been able to check out that much of that because she's just not usually in the mood for it.
Sure.
And she likes foreign stuff too, actually. But before we get too far away from Vincent Vaughn, and this new project sounds really cool, the Dragged Across Concrete. I wonder what that's going to be about. But Vincent Vaughn was also in the A Cool Dry Place, which I always thought
Joey
was
Lauren Adams, right?
Tremendous, yeah. Joey Lauren Adams and I just thought that was a fantastic movie and just a great vehicle for him, and he delivers just such a solid performance. And it wasn't like a big movie, but it is really a great drama. And also The Prime Gig, which is sort of a
Boiler Room.
It's very similar to Boiler Room.
Yeah.
Features Ed Harris.
Oh, he's such a good actor.
And a bunch of really good character actors.
He's kind of an asshole in real life, but yeah.
And Julia Ormond.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember Legends of the Fall is one of my favorite movies, and like, I saw that movie and I was in love with Julia Ormond for
pretty much she's tremendous in it.
Yeah.
Julio
Ormond, I love you. I'm sorry.
It's completely flown under the radar, but
Yeah.
The prime gig, you've got to watch it. It really is that good, and if I hype it up too much, then you know, it won't deliver, but he used to be Vincent Vaughn used to be in all these cool indie movies, and then for a long time he did the very cookie cutter Judd Apatow buddy comedy stuff, which is a lot of fun, and I'm sure the paycheck is where it's at, but he doesn't look like he's enjoying it half the time. I mean, certainly not anymore. It's just like, I get up, I go to work, whatever. I can't wait to clock out.
Getting back, I know I talked about Sublime 99, but getting back to that movie, like, I felt that was like the first real Vince Vaughn performance that he's done in a long time.
Agreed.
I mean, he was just, I mean, I'm not gonna say he was robbed of an Oscar nomination because I knew that wouldn't happen. But like, it completely changed my way of looking at him as an actor, because I mean, for most of the last decade and a half, he's been in shit movies. But so I went on IMDb and looked about this Dragged Across Concrete. So I'm gonna give you the synopsis, okay?
Sure.
And it sounds like it's the script centers on two policemen, one an old-timer, guess who, Gibson, the other his volatile young partner, Vaughn, who's not really that young anymore.
Young?
Yeah. Who find themselves suspended when a video of their strong-arm tactics become the media's cause du jour.
Let's say younger.
Younger, yeah. Low on cash and with no other options, these two embittered soldiers descend into the criminal underworld to gain their just due, but instead find far more than they wanted awaiting them in the shadows. That sounds like a good movie.
Sounds bitchin'.
It sounds really good. It's, you know, a movie I really like that nobody, some people have heard of, but not everybody, Running Scared with Paul Walker. Have you seen that one?
Definitely.
Oh, that's a great movie. And you know, it's the one movie, I mean, it's just one of those movies where you just never know where it's going. And I don't even think it knows where it's going. Like, I mean, there's whole sections that are, I'm like, what? Where is this coming from?
Yeah.
And honestly, it does. Well, it features Paul Walker's probably his best performance. I never really thought much of him as an actor. I'm sorry.
I did Paul Walker. I think he was a cool
dude.
He was
likable, yeah.
But I think what a lot of people remember about that movie is Vera Farmiga's sort of scene where the plot digresses and they find this
kiddie porn dungeon
haunting
pedophile
cell. And it is just one of the most bleak and terrifying scenes ever.
Yeah, it's without no contest, my favorite part of the whole movie.
Oh, man.
And maybe I don't know what that says about me, but like the fact that like they just decided, I mean, because they could totally excise that scene from the whole movie and it would have been fine.
Would have flowed.
It would have flowed, you know, perfectly naturally, you know, organically. But they inserted that scene in, and I was like, okay, that movie just elevated it to greatness. And then if you just
the movie is at its heart about the kid, finding the kid, saving the kid.
Kind of, the gun itself, though, that the kid's carrying is kind of a MacGuffin, though, you know what I mean?
Sure, like, exactly.
Yeah, and that's what I like about it, yeah.
And clearly the director wanted to say something about pedophiles, so that's, right. That's fine. But
well, who doesn't want to talk about
it? Yeah, they're low-hanging fruit. I'm not saying,
I'm
like,
not endorsing
guys,
pedophilia.
Guys, lay off the pedophiles. Come on. Live and let live, but
9-year-olds, dude.
And of course, when she pulls the, I think she says something like, 911, please come to this address. There's been a shooting, and then she hangs up, bang.
It's just fantastic.
You know, the director got to do some stuff in that scene. That you don't like that woman passes the door, and the door has that sort of frosted glass, but it's not her shadow. It looks like Nosferatu,
or some
sort of that pointy ear,
like
Very goblin.
Yeah, it, with the pointy ear, kind of like a Rumpelstiltskin almost.
And I mean, it's a weird thing to insert into something that's supposed to be this sort of gritty crime story. But I wonder, you know, what would the movie have been like if there had been more of that more of that subtext in the rest of it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, the hockey scene at the end where they're, you know, hitting hockey pucks at people and,
yeah.
That's sort of weird. But I mean that.
Yeah. Did you see Mom and Dad with Nicolas Cage?
I don't think I did.
Yeah. Nicolas Cage, that I've talked to other people. He's really hit and miss, like, you know, as he gets older. Like, Mom and Dad, basically, it stars him and Selma Blair, and there's, like, this epidemic where people hear, like, this fuzz on the TV, and, like, parents start killing their children. And it's basically Home Alone, but with, instead of, and I was telling my last guest, instead of burglars, it's parents, and it's, like, it's from the guys who did, it's one of the co-directors of Crank, and Crank 2, and, Gamer, And it's an hour and 23 minutes, and then
wasn't there some movie that was the opposite of that? Like a bunch of people are in a high school, and the kids go crazy, and they try to kill the teachers.
Yeah, wasn't that the Cooties?
I don't recall. I didn't see either of them, but yeah. I like the idea. I like when somebody takes an idea like that and takes it to its illogical conclusion.
I know there was the Battle Royale. Yeah, have you ever heard of that one?
Sure,
yeah.
Sure.
I've still never seen that movie.
The Hunger Games, only in Japanese.
Yeah, pretty much.
Battle Royale is excellent. I dug it. I haven't seen it in a long time.
I think I, at one point, owned the book. I don't know if I do anymore. But, yeah, I mean, speaking of books, I mean, what are you reading right now?
Let me think.
I mean, you got a kid. Do you read now? I mean, do you have time?
I read. I fall into the trap of rereading stuff a lot.
I do like Stephen King.
But I read The Late Show by Michael Connelly, who's the author of the Harry Bosch series.
Yeah, Harry Bosch, yeah. Jack McAvoy, I think, or what was it? He did The Poet. He did The Poet and Bloodwork.
The Poet, yes.
Jack, one of my favorite.
McAvoy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, I really enjoy Michael Connelly, although his prose is just super dry for me.
Yeah.
It is like
it's pretty cut and dry. I mean, there's really no flourishes to it.
There's just a ton of his ad nauseum exposition.
Yeah.
And I also read the most recent Virgil Flowers. I read a lot of crime fiction, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
I read the most recent Virgil Flowers novel by John Sanford. And that was tremendous. That was really excellent. And I'm trying to recall the name, which shouldn't escape me, but it has. And, you know, John Sanford is always just a joy, and his prose is just so Minnesotan. I mean, obviously we're here in Minnesota,
right?
It's so realistically depicted. It's so believable and conversational that it's just like, well, yeah, of course, you know, of course he would say that. And just a lot of fun. Holy Ghost is the name of the title of the novel.
Okay.
I've got the Virgil Flowers Investigates a Miracle and a Murder.
A miracle.
It's about this town that's basically on the verge of collapse. Some little Minnesota town that's got, you know, a couple thousand people living there and no jobs, and it's really depressing. Everybody's moving away.
Yeah.
And a high school kid comes up with the idea to kickstart the town's economy. And so a couple months later, there is a sighting of the Virgin Mary at the local Catholic church. And it's captured on video, and it's sort of attracts a wild amount of tourism.
Right.
But then out of left field, and right in front of the church, somebody gets shot. So Virgil Flowers has to pack it up from Mankato, Minnesota.
Really?
And yes, Virgil is a character who lives in Mankato, believe it or not, and go to a place called Pinion, Minnesota, which I'm not sure is real or fictional, and investigate the murder. And Virgil Flowers is just a gem of a character, just waiting for somebody to make a movie about.
Really?
Yeah.
Like Jack Reacher or something.
I mean, Virgil is such a likable guy and so Minnesotan. I wonder who could actually play him. If Josh Hartnett was going to make a comeback, yeah. Although Virgil Flowers is blonde, but he's sort of tall and lanky and he was a baseball player in college, I think, or something like that.
Yeah.
Speaking
of Josh Hartnett, you've seen Lucky Number 11, right?
Sure.
That's a great movie.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
I really wish that movie had made him a bigger star than... I think
it was confusing to people.
I think people were expecting, like...
he was in Bunraku, too. And if somebody knows what that movie is about or who it's for...
Yeah, what is that?
It is just a bizarre... I think the idea is it
a sequel, Bunraku? Bunraku as well, not Bunraku.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, and I mean, it's got Josh Hartnett in it, yeah. Right? It's not Bunraku is a very confusing story. It's got Woody Harrelson in it.
What?
And
I haven't seen this?
Japanese pop star named Gackt. And it's, I think, Ron Perlman, too. As
ooh, remember. Ron Perlman. Okay. You got me there.
Demi Moore. But it's this sort of alternate world where he's sort of out for revenge. It plays out like a Western, but with knives and swords.
I'm looking this up. How did this even come to theaters?
I don't know.
I'm looking at it right now.
2011.
Josh Hartnett, Woody Harrelson, Gackt, Kevin McKidd, who I think I know who that is, with Ron Perlman and Demi Moore, and nobody... This is the first time
hearing of it. It's very dystopian. So imagine, like, Sin City as a Western with swords and knives instead of guns.
Sin City's, yeah.
It's set in a future where guns have been outlawed.
Yeah.
And somebody wanted to make a Western, and do it with swords. So that was the frame that they used, and it's interesting, but you kind of go like, okay, who's this for? Like, like
sometimes you gotta ask that. Who is this movie for? Like, you know, like know your audience.
Like the RZA as Iron Fist. It's fun to watch. Don't get me wrong, but
right.
I'm just like, the RZA made this movie because he was like, oh, I got money, I can make a movie.
Oh,
I
could be in a movie. He made this?
No, I'm just saying, it's sort of that same sort of, you know, martial arts as a Western.
Right.
So it's that style and that frame.
Yeah.
And
Man with the Golden Arm, wasn't it? That he did.
Man with the Iron Fist.
Iron Fist, yeah. Man with Golden Arms, Frank Sinatra. Anyway.
And he, and first off, I mean, you're a black man in Asia. Like,
right.
That didn't happen for centuries, you know? Like, I don't think that's historically inaccurate for me to say that. But, shit, it's so much fun to watch. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. I mean... I dug it, and if the RZA didn't make that movie, I mean, who's gonna, you know?
Yeah.
Wesley Snipes is not gonna make that movie.
I'm still trying to figure out, is it RZA or Urza? I can never. I've some. It really okay.
Don't overthink it.
I know. Because I've been.
He's not going to listen to this podcast. First off,
I'm up at nights thinking.
The Rizzo's not like. What'd you say about the man with the arm fist? Fuck you, Hal.
Yeah.
Don't make me come tell you twice. You know.
Yeah.
That's not gonna happen. All right.
Yeah. So I see you got your bracelets. So how's that? Are you still making those?
For your listeners. Yeah. One of my very smallest claims to fame is that I make bracelets out of bicycle spokes.
That's really cool. I've always thought that was really cool.
Thank you very much. Yeah. I sort of fell into it. I used to be a bike mechanic in a former life, and I was goofing off after work one day when I probably should have been doing something better. Mm-hmm. And
that's sort of my whole life. I was doing something when I should have been doing something better.
Well, and I think it's an example of me being more Japanese than I really am. I took this one idea, and I hyper-focused on it for a while. And to the same extent, like trying to build a podcast. And I didn't have any big expectations about what people would think about it. I just said, well, you know, I want to be able to wear this thing that sort of... because I didn't wear jewelry. I had no use for jewelry. But, like, first off, stainless steel is not the same as gold or silver. You know, definitely different, right. more butch connotation, maybe.
Right.
But also, I mean, cycling is definitely a part of my identity as something that I, you know, definitely as a hobby.
I've seen
you
ride your bike.
But also, something I did for a long time to make my living.
Yeah.
And I'm still making them. I actually had a really weird experience 2 weekends ago, maybe.
Ooh,
it was.
Weird experiences. I like weird. What's going on? What happened?
So there's a store up in the Twin Cities that sells my bracelets. They buy them from me wholesale, and they sell them at their store. And
that's awesome.
So, I mean, like, twice a year I'll get an email from them. And this year and probably last year, too, I've just been super behind the eight ball, and I didn't get their order filled in a timely fashion, mm-hmm. which is entirely on me, and I need to do a better job. But I got a phone call from this woman. So it's just a weird day, first off, and I'm sorry, this will be another digression.
Right.
A buddy of mine, he messaged me out of the blue, somebody I hadn't talked to in a long time, and I don't interact with very frequently, but a nice guy, from an old job that I used to work at, and he said, look, I'm in kind of a bad place, my health is not great, my family life is sort of screwed up right now, and my dog is effed up, and I need to have my dog put down, and he's got this old pit bull, and she was on her last legs, and he said, look, I don't want to go, can you just do this for me? And I mean you'll probably hear from your listeners, you know, that's kind of a sad thing to do, because a lot of people take that sort of seriously, where like, you should be there to hold the dog's hand.
Right. Yeah. No. Absolutely. Yeah. That's,
however they do it.
Yeah. That.
I've not ever been a dog owner, so none of this has ever occurred to me.
And he's asked you to put. He's asked you specifically to put his dog down.
No, he doesn't want me to kill the dog. He wants me to drive the dog to the veterinarian.
No,
yeah. Because that would be a different conversation.
That would be a very different.
And it's like in St. James, so
yeah,
so
that makes sense.
I always want to like help out and be a good friend.
Completely rationalize everything by
but
saying.
But at the same time, it's sort of grim, right?
Yeah,
and so,
absolutely.
So I drive over there and I get a blanket in the back seat, and this dog does not have the use of its back legs at all, and it's sort of incontinent. And I'm like, is my car gonna get gross and whatever? And it's like a 40-minute drive out to St. James, you know?
Yeah.
So
I worked in
St.
James.
So I put the dog in the back seat, and I'm already like running on maybe very little sleep.
How recent
is
this?
With the baby, this is like 2-3 weeks ago.
No kidding.
Yeah.
This is very recent.
So I put the dog in the back seat, and I get started, and I'm making a very gentle left turn, but the dog has sort of, like many dogs do, decided that it wants to stick its head up in between the front seats and be able to have chit chat with me for some reason. And I'm not a dog person, and I don't want to be mean to the dog, but the goddamn dog, like, as I turn left, the dog falls down into the footwell of the back seat.
Oh, shit.
On its back, it's whining, it's sad, it's really bumming me out. I don't want to be there in the first place. And so I have to pull over, and I have to right the dog, and I sort of try and wrap it in the blanket a little bit and hook one of the seat belts around it to prevent it from doing this again.
Oh.
And I'm like, I'm sorry, buddy. Look, just try and sit still for me here. I don't, you know, none of this is happy.
Like
and,
a sad version of Turner and Hooch.
Yeah. Well, so I get going again, and the dog, like another 10 minutes down the road, decides that it needs to be faced the other way. But it doesn't have the use of its back legs, so it's sort of like folding itself over itself on the back seat, getting all twisted up in the seatbelt that I hooked there.
Right.
And it's whining and yipping, and I'm like, just calm down, buddy. Please, can you just do that for me? And it finally settles down, and I get to St. James, and I pick up the dog, and I carry the dog into this veterinary clinic, and I say, you know, I'm really sorry. I'm not a dog guy. I've never owned a dog.
Yeah.
My friend told me to bring this dog. They knew exactly what was going on. You know, they had the appointment all set up. I was like, I'm going to leave now. This whole thing's kind of bumming me out. I'm really sorry. And they were like, you know, I mean, the kids that work there, you know, if you're like 21 and you work at the veterinary clinic, it's because you love animals. It's not because you love destroying dogs or whatever. But
sure.
So I'm like, you know, the dog's last moments in life will be better served with these young kids that are going to, you know, chill it out and give it a treat and then put it to sleep.
Yeah.
And the dog's, So I left, and I drove to like a Subway, and I had breakfast, and this was early in the morning. And then I'm pulling out of the parking lot, and I, you know, headed back to Mankato, and I get this phone call, and this woman says, you don't know me. I got your phone number off of your website. I hope that's okay. Bentspokes.com, if somebody wants to stalk me, I guess.
Sure.
I'll
plug it.
She says, my brother-in-law was an avid cyclist. He, you know, was a big part of his life. He recently passed away in a cycling accident. He was riding off-road, had a fickle... You know, it can happen to anybody at any time. It usually doesn't. Right. People ride within their ability. People do the right thing. They wear helmets. This guy was wearing a helmet. I'm sure he was doing all the right stuff. You know, just super unfortunate, super tragic. He left a family behind. Yeah. He was, by all
terrible,
reports, a super nice dude. He was... I'm probably about my age, I think, or not much older, and he loved to ride bikes. And this very nice woman says, I would like to have enough of your bracelets, spoke bicycles, you know, bracelets made out of bicycle spokes from bike wheels, enough of them to give to most of the people that are going to be at his wake.
Wow.
And
that's a job.
I mean, they're stainless steel, so they're made to a certain size, and I don't know how to predict, you know, all the sizes for who's going to attend this wake, but you know, and it's still sort of early in the morning, and she's like, well, I really want to do this. I, you know, I just thought it would be a nice token, you know, for people to remember him, and that people would be able to cherish. And I went to the store where I remembered they sell them, and they had like two.
Right.
So I'm like, yeah, and that's my fault because I didn't fill this order. Right. So I'm like,
you
okay, let me figure this out. And I went home and I dug around the house and I found what bracelets I had made in however many sizes. And I stayed up until about 3:30 in the morning that night making more bracelets and organized them into sizes and went ahead and... I called her later that day, and I was like, you know, I live in Mankato. If I ship them, they should get there in time. But the wake was like in 3 days or something like that. And I was, yeah. She's like, yeah, if it doesn't get here though, I'm going to be crushed. And
Mankato's not
that far, you know? Right. So she goes, I'll just drive down and pick him up. And holy crap, right? So, so she did. She drove down from the Twin Cities. I met her at the Coffee Hag at like 10 o'clock in the morning.
Coffee
and,
Hag!
Sorry. Yeah, pretty awesome. And I, you know, she wrote me a check and she was very gracious and I tried to give her a good price and I also compensated the store where she would have bought them because, mm-hmm. you know, they would have made their,
right,
their markup profits on it. Yeah, I mean, that whole thing was sort of heavy that, you know, there's this very
tough day
trinkety piece of artwork that I make that I think is sort of clever, but not of heavy consequence.
Right.
And
it's your, I,
when somebody takes that and they apply this very deep meaning to it, it sort of makes you stop and think, you know, I mean,
absolutely.
And people have often said, well, you're an artist. And I'm like, no, I'm not really an artist. I'm a bike mechanic that makes this stuff. You know, it's not art to me. I mean, I can whip one out in about 5 minutes and,
right.
And I like them and I think that they're clever and I think that they have a good aesthetic, but I mean, I don't,
it's just something you do.
Yeah. I don't regard that as art. And I mean, I think if it was art, it would keep evolving too, because yeah. I sort of got a design that I like and I stick with it. And I've been many times told, well, you should do something a little different next year and that way you'll sell a bunch more. And I'm like, yeah, I haven't thought of anything I like more than this, so I'm just not going to do it.
Yeah.
And I've seen some very cool original bracelet designs made out of bicycle spokes that are awesome, different shapes and stuff that I wouldn't know where to start. But I like my design. It is original. It is.
I've seen them. They're awesome.
Thanks.
I mean, I'm looking at them right now.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think they're pretty clean and, yay. And, yeah.
Yeah.
You're welcome to one, man.
Are you serious?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh my God, hey, man. This is like a,
is that,
no,
it's too perfect. Big, too small.
No, it's, I think it's perfect.
All right.
I think,
well,
it's
there
perfect.
You go, dude.
All right. I'll gain like 5 more pounds or something. But, well, but no, absolutely. So, I mean, I know time is of the essence here. You got to get going here pretty quick.
I'm
but
starting to, this has been a long recording.
Yes. My latest show that just dropped today,
mm-hmm.
hour and 25 minutes. So,
and we've been here for how long? What, an hour and a half?
Feel like it.
No. But, and I don't know how much we really talked about movies.
You know what? That's okay though, man. This is what it's all about. It's all about bullshit and just making it putting our stamp on it, you know. And
right.
I enjoyed hearing about your bicycle, your bracelets and your story of putting the dog to sleep or not, yeah. you know, not putting him to, but what, you know, whatever, you know, that
yeah.
this is what it's all about. So, Any final thoughts for?
You know, I had planned on talking about other movies, and we went and talked about a bunch of movies that nobody's talked about for for years, probably, right?
Yeah.
Like arcane stuff. We should at some point get together and talk about the Christopher Robin movie.
I haven't seen that.
Well, once you've seen it, then we can talk about it.
We can talk about it, yeah.
With Ewan McGregor, who I think is terrific. And
yeah, Ewan McGregor is fantastic.
Yeah. And I'm trying to think, because that was something I had sort of made a mental note, like, and again, I'm not 100% sure who that's for. I mean, stories that are based around a children's story that are clearly meant to be a grown-up drama,
right.
of some sort.
Right.
But, I mean, I think that it's a really good story.
In my old...
Yeah, and I mean, I hope it does well. I mean, I don't know.
You said you also saw that Mile 20, was it Mile 22?
Mile 22, which is under a lot of scrutiny for being hard to understand, I think. It's very kinetic. Yeah. I mean, it's like The Kingdom in that it really moves along at a fast pace, yeah. And it absolutely adheres to that very realistic vision of violence. Although, seeing Iwo, now I can't remember his last name, seeing him do his whatever that Thai martial art is, I think it's called Silcot. I'm gonna say it wrong unless I Silat Pengkok. No, Pengkok Silat.
There we go.
Yeah, that's probably wrong. Anyway, martial arts is probably a little more. I don't know. It's fantastic to watch on the screen, and it's very fast paced.
Right.
So
you know, like, I've really grown to like Mark Wahlberg as an actor. Like, I used to think he was just kind of a serviceable actor. You know, you put him on there and you watch him and he'd be okay. I mean, he'd not mind blowing, but I think he's actually become a pretty decent actor as far as not only just dramatic work, like in, you know, Patriot's Day. And
sure.
Yeah, and then the movie with the oil spill. Oh, what was it called?
Sure, Deepwater Horizon.
Deepwater. And then he has the comic chops. I mean, and the other guys with Will Ferrell and
oh Lord.
I mean, he's grown to be a pretty eclectic.
He really gets some choice.
Yeah,
some choice material. And I mean. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people will say, you know, because he's still doing those Transformer movies too.
Yeah, and I think there's one more, and there's Bumblebee. I don't think he's going to be in that one.
No,
But yeah, I think those have. I literally have only seen the first one, and that was the end of it for me. I mean, it wasn't bad. I liked it, but I was just like, how many of these can they do?
Well, at some point, if you've seen one, you've seen them all. Yeah. I mean, the robots turn into cars, and they turn back into robots. But, and that was before. Before Wahlberg was involved in it,
yeah.
Too. I mean,
yeah, that was Shia.
Shia LaBeouf has gone off the rails.
Yeah, I think
that guy.
Yeah, honestly,
did you see the video of him cussing some guy out and calling him a racist over French fries?
No.
Yeah,
I've heard about it, but
he
I'm
is
not...
off the deep end. Well, yeah. And I mean,
no.
He pissed off the internet, right? And 4chan, like, people say that 4chan and, you know, the weaponized autism that is the internet.
Yeah, right.
Is some kind of a right-wing. There's nothing right-wing about 4chan.
Yeah.
First off, I mean, it's 4chan is weaponized anarchy as far as I'm concerned. But they made it their duty to torture him because... Yeah. They found his posturing to be ridiculous.
Yeah.
As do I. He seems to be another person of very strong convictions, of which he does not seem to be able to elucidate the justification for them.
I think it's tremendous to be
against racism. I just think that people see racism in some very confusing places.
Right.
And I mean, I think that, like, if you piss off a guy, like, say, you know, you're something about how you mow your lawn pisses off your neighbor, or you don't rake your leaves the right way, or something. And you got beef with that guy, like, that's a problem because he lives next door, but he might move away or, you know, something might happen, you know, maybe you guys make up. But when you piss off the internet, That's just never going away. All right. That's like,
yeah.
That's like if you were able to piss off the ocean and the ocean could take it out on you. Like, you are just, you are hosed, buddy. You will not win that fight. And I don't care if you have Michael Bay dollars and you have, you know,
right.
Well, I hooked up with Megan Fox. Well, all right. High five, dude. But you pissed off the internet now and there's no going back from that.
Megan Fox, man. She's just, ugh.
Yeah.
She was hot in the first one, and now she looks like Joan Rivers. Like, she's gotten so much Botox. Like, she
I don't know what she looks like now. She was in something.
She was in The New Girl recently.
Yeah, she did some guest spots on The New Girl, and I'm told that she's friends with Zooey Deschanel, which seems wildly
weird. Yeah, I actually really liked what is it, Jennifer's Body?
Yeah, I didn't watch that.
That was actually really good.
That which makes me think of Amanda Seyfried, which makes me think of A Million Ways to Die in the West, which I just watched week and a half ago. It's hilarious. You haven't seen it?
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen Ted. Somebody let me borrow Ted. I still haven't watched it.
So watch Ted and then watch A Million Ways to Die in the West. It's so much fun. Charlize Theron can just be, you know, stupid hot and not take herself seriously.
Yeah.
One of the lines in the movie with Charlize Theron, she says, what better way to make your girlfriend, your ex-girlfriend, super jealous by showing up at the dance with a really hot chick like me? And he goes, oh, very confident of yourself, right? And she goes, yeah, but I've got great tits or something like that. You know, like, it's, and that's not something that Charlize Theron is going to get to say in movies like Monster.
Or Mad Max Fury Road.
Did she not say that in Mad Max Fury Road?
That did not come up in competition.
Maybe I need to rewatch
when she was pulling off Immortan Joe's face.
She's like, "Well, I've got this mechanical arm, but I've got great tits."
Yeah. Well, so we've resorted to talking about the tits of Charlize Theron, and I think we've come to the end of our show. But you know what I honestly really would love to do is maybe in January have a couple of other buddies. I've got that turntable. And just do a round table review of different movies that we liked from the year. I mean, I think that'd be fun. I mean, we may not all like each other personally, but that's what it's all about, man.
That I'm the pariah in the group. I can predict that with a high level of probability.
Yeah, that's what's going to make the episode.
Being that this is a college town and but I can say, I would love to collaborate. That'd be terrific. And anytime you want to rap about movies, maybe I can do a better job of having of being focused next time.
Yeah,
I think we
had a good run.
Yeah, fair enough.
All right.
Cheers.
Okay, boys and girls, neurotics. That was our show for today. I want to thank Michael Murphy again for making a very impromptu appearance. And he basically came in, said, hey, man, let's just start recording this shit. This is gold, man. Let's just cover, do a recap, as we say at my other job. We talked about some crime authors. We talked about Milla Jovovich, which, come on, you can't not talk about Milla Jovovich. And we talked about, putting bike spoke bracelets and having to put a dog to sleep, which is really sad. That was probably the sad part of the episode. But, I mean, man, we really covered a lot of ground. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed it. And I hope you guys have a great day and a great weekend moving forward, and have a happy, healthy Thanksgiving. Thanks, guys. One day at a time.